First of all, I would like to thank you very much for the invitation to the 70th National SOPSI Congress here in Rome. It is my pleasure to speak again about our research program in front of an Italian auditory, and I feel among scientific friends and companions to whom we have had fruitful cooperative relations for many years. My presentation today is on worldwide approaches to prediction and prevention of schizophrenia. In order to present this new field of research, I chose 8 items. These 8 items here for my presentation today, and I would now like to start with the first one, the rationale for prediction and prevention of first episode psychosis. Some years ago, the World Health Organization declared as one of their primary goals the reduction of the burden associated with mental, neurological, and substance abuse disorders. And prevention was thereby regarded as obviously the most effective way to do so. One self-evident target among these disorders is psychosis, and especially schizophrenia. That is one of the 6 leading causes of years lived with disability worldwide. It is becoming increasingly clear that schizophrenia is a complex disorder with polygenic heredity, as we heard in the excellent Weinberger talk, and that its pathogenesis is greatly influenced by interactions between different genes and interactions between genes and the environment. As with all other complex diseases, research is now characterizing the polygenic predisposition and clarifying its influence on the development of schizophrenic phenotype. Research methods range, as here indicated, from molecular genetics via proteome research to cell biology, neurophysiology, and neuropsychology. Here you can see current pathologic concepts and research strategies brief alluded. And you might understand how helpful it would be to intervene preventively already in this early phase here of life, in which is determined whether a risk carrier will remain healthy or develop schizophrenia. Indeed, with all these methods, an increased risk of schizophrenia has been identified. However, the currently recognized neurobiological risk factors are not sufficiently predictive to allow the development and application of selective prevention measures for asymptomatic persons at risk. The identified gene variants, for example, only slightly increase the lifetime risk, and like all other possible biomarkers, have as yet not contributed uniquely to the prediction of psychosis. There are also established environmental risk factors for schizophrenia, listed here, A2E, pregnancy or birth complications, growing up in large cities, IQ, low but normal, and drug consumption. However, with odds ratios around 2, here each of these factors also appears to increase the life risk, the lifetime risk of the disease only slightly. Thus, the currently known risk factors, either alone or taken altogether, cannot be used for prediction and prevention without knowledge on the complete predispositional basis and the gene-gene and gene-environmental interactions, which are probably numerous. In view of this situation, it may be argued that the current efforts towards prediction and prevention are still premature, and that further progress is needed. However, a different perspective has emerged from the work of the early recognition and prevention centers, established first in Melbourne, Australia, and in Cologne, Germany, in the mid of 1990s, and later on in many other places around the world. It resulted from retrospective research of the early course of psychosis, in which the pathophysiologically active disturbance in brain development extends beyond these early abnormalities in behavior into a psychopathological definable initial prodrome here, with these early at-risk states of psychosis and these late at-risk of psychosis states. First episode psychosis research had shown that the transition into early psychosis is preceded in about 70% to nearly 100% of cases by such consecutive clinical high-risk states, which last for an average of 5 to 6 years. The period over with the FEP remains untreated, and the preceding at-risk states remain unidentified, correlates with many markedly disadvantages for the individuals affected and their families. This does not only provide strong arguments in favor to treating the FEP, here, early psychosis, as early as possible, but has also led to a systematic effort to decrease the incidence of psychosis through indicated prevention. This brings me to my next point, the prediction of FEP in early at risk of psychosis states using basic symptom criteria. As you can see here, Professor Carlo Margini introduced the basic symptom concept to the Italian psychopathologists and edited a very beautiful Italian version of the Bond scale of assessment of basic symptoms. And now, if you look at these advanced versions of the Bond scale, the Schizophrenia Prunennis instrument with an adult and a child and youth version, it is thanks to Professor Ferro, I see him under us, and his working group, that this attractive version is available in the Italian language and in many other languages too. Basic symptoms are subtle, mainly only self-experienced deficits of several cognitive defective domains. They can appear more or less continuously between 2 months and 35 years prior to the progression to the first psychotic symptoms. In the Bond study, one of the large European long-term studies, basic symptoms were found pre-psychotically in 37 of patients, and additional 15% had shown an outpost syndrome, as you can see here, with the same kind of disturbances spontaneously remitting after their first occurrence, prior to the transition to first episode after reoccurrence. From the theoretical point of view, my academic mentor, the creator of the basic symptom concept, Gerd Huber, who passed away recently, looked upon this self-experience deficit as a primary symptom formation close to the brain organic substrate of the disease, mainly here in the limbic system, as indicated, and exactly this he wanted to express with the term basic symptoms. The German approach to prediction and prevention of psychosis emanates from this basic disorder conception and was developed in 3 steps. It all started with the questions if these basic symptoms could be shown to be the phenomenological basis of psychotic symptoms, which first led to our Bond transition sequences study, based on the results published in 1992, that certain basic symptoms indeed seem to precede to the onset of certain psychotic symptoms. The second question arose, if these basic symptoms were also predictive of schizophrenia. We were impressed by the apparent relationship between first-rank symptoms, still most important for the diagnosis of psychosis according to ICD-10 and DSM-4, and certain, especially cognitive perceptive basic symptoms, and hypothesized now that these basic symptoms should also be able to predict the diagnosis relevant first-rank symptoms and therefore could be usable for diagnosing schizophrenia in the initial prodrome phase. To test this hypothesis in the Cologne Early Recognition CER study published in 2001, all those patients were identified who had been examined with the DSABS, the Bond scale, and the PSA-9, as you can see here, and who had not shown any sign or psychotic symptom of psychotic symptoms then before or before in their lives. 116, and of the 385 patients here meeting these criteria and could be contacted again between 1995 and 1999. At such high numbers, methodological thorough analyses of predictive value of BSABS subsyndromes and single basic symptoms could be carried out. Only one of the five basic symptom clusters, the subsyndrome information processing disturbances, reached the quality of an optimal diagnostic test and with a sensitivity, as you can see here, of 5.6 was still rather frequent in the initial prodrome. As analysis of single symptoms showed 10 symptoms, these 10 symptoms had especially contributed to the good performance of the subsyndrome. Each of them had been reported at baseline by at least 25% of patients later making the transition to schizophrenia, had a positive predictive value, as you can see here, of at least 0.70 and had led to less than, important point, less to than 8% of false positive predictions of schizophrenia. And these disturbances of thought processes, speech, and perception were widely the same that had earlier been found in our transition sequences study at the beginning of first rank symptom development. In the following, the CER study findings were confirmed in two independent samples and have then led to the formulation of the two criteria for the definition and specification of early at-risk psychosis states. The first criterion that consists of these 10 cognitive perceptive basic symptoms and is abbreviated as COPA, as you can see here, and the second criterion in which a cluster of 9 cognitive basic symptoms had repeatedly been selected as most predictive was called cognitive disturbances, COCDIS. The transition rate throughout the average follow-up period of roughly 10 years was 65% for COPA and even 79% for COCDIS, with the majority of transitions occurring within the first 3 years past baseline, as you can see here for COPA and for COCDIS. As a consequence of these findings, the international research today uses COPA and COCDIS in defining the early at-risk of psychosis state in the clinical high-risk staging model shown at the beginning. Now, the next point, the prediction of FAP in late at-risk of psychosis states using ultra-high-risk criteria. In the same last 20 years in which the basic symptom criteria had been developed and validated in Cologne and our Melbourne colleagues around Patrick McGorry suggested the ultra-high-risk definition to picture an imminent risk for psychosis. This is a prodrome within the last year prior to frank psychosis. Herein, these attenuated symptoms here and these brief, limited, intermittent psychotic symptoms constituted the symptomatic criteria for an at-risk state close in time to conversion to frank psychosis. The ultra-high-risk approach, besides in two, the two symptomatic criteria, had also included results of mainly genetic high-risk research and defined this third state criterion here, in which unspecific mental problems such as depression or anxiety were only considered prodromal when they were accompanied by a recent significant loss of psychosocial functioning and presence of a risk factor for psychosis, such as the diagnosis of schizotypal personality here or a positive family history of psychosis. When we introduced the predictive basic symptom as a definition of an earlier at-risk state, we place this third criterion, as you can see here, with basic symptoms, as we felt that with only unspecific symptoms involved, it delineates a much less imminent risk of conversion than the attenuated and transient psychotic symptoms. The resulted clinical staging model, which suggests a syndromal sequence from unspecific prodromal symptoms to predictive basic symptoms and then to APS and to brief limited intermittent symptoms and then to full-blown psychotic symptoms, was recently strongly supported. All the relevant studies from Melbourne, from Manchester, from Yale, from London, as first showed an average annual transition rate of 38%, mainly for the attenuated psychotic symptoms in ultra-high-risk samples not especially treated for psychosis. Meanwhile, there is also a very thorough meta-analysis which clearly demonstrates that the transition risk needs to be corrected downwards. Here you can see the studies included, and that met the quality criteria for this meta-analysis. Again, studies from Melbourne and Cologne, as well as from Basel and Amsterdam. The transition rates were 22, as you can see here in the first year, 29 within the second year, and around 36% in this third year after the examination. This brings me to my next point, the attempt to stronger individualized prediction. Meanwhile, the possibilities for risk estimation by means of the two broad sets of criteria, the UHR and the BS criteria, have again been notably improved. Who is at what risk? This is the most important question for selected, individualized, and personalized prevention measures. In the context of the European Prediction of Psychosis Study, abbreviated EPOS, whose results were published in 2010, as you can see here under this title, we developed a so-called prognostic index for the prediction of psychotic first episodes for the first time. In oncology, for example, such indices have already well established and are in use for multivariate clinical staging of the respective disease. For the EPOS prediction model, the resulting prognostic scores led to a further subdivision into these four risk classes. Here, risk class 1 has a 3.5 incidence rate of transition each after 9 and 12 and 18 months, whereas the transition rate here in the risk class 4 amounts to 48 until after 9 16% after 12 and 85% after 18 months. Thus, risk estimation can be individually tailored and utilized for the prediction of time and probability of transition to the psychosis first episode for each person seeking help in the early detection centers. In the prognostic index category 1, the incidence of transitions to be expected is already 16, 7 times, but in the index category 4 is 1,621, as high as the 18 months incidence rate of psychosis in the general population. Thereby, one also gets a much better basis of decision for the recommendation of the appropriate early intervention for the individual persons, which highly significantly differs from risk categories 4 to 1. That brings me to my next point, the search for biomarkers of the symptomatologically and functionally defined early and late as risk of psychosis states. These at-risk states could best be compared with the category of mild cognitive impairment, which is nosologically non-specific but often already in need of treatment. This condition indicates the risk for Alzheimer's dementia with a transition rate comparable to the at-risk of psychosis states. Therefore, mild cognitive impairment plays a role in the development of prediction and prevention strategies in dementia comparable to the at-risk states of psychosis in the field of schizophrenia. In mild cognitive impairment, if mild cognitive impairment had clinically been diagnosed, additional neurobiological investigations have to be carried out in order to clarify which pathological process is assigned to the respective cognitive deficit. These include, for example, an amyloid PET or investigations of amyloid markers in the cerebrospinal fluid. And as you can see here, in pathological cerebral fluid, the progression to Alzheimer's dementia in fact dramatically increases with the following 16 months. Such markers increasing the predictive power of the clinically risk criteria are also being sought for the at-risk of psychosis states on all appropriate levels from molecular genetics via proteome research to brain structural and functional imaging, neurophysiology and neuropsychology, as you can here see. One of the most promising methods is currently the brain structural imaging based on support vector machine classification. This study revealed very significant prediction values, as you can see here, to clarify the independent power of this method. Together with Dr. Koutsouleris from Munich, we have just submitted an application to the European Commission for the support of a large research project with several participating research groups from Europe. Another particularly promising biomarker for risk enrichment is the neurophysiological paradigm of the mismatch negativity. Our own findings reveal that patients in at-risk states with mismatch negativity abnormalities, as you can see here, more often significantly convert in first episode psychosis in 85% versus 34%, and also significantly faster in 13 versus 20 months. In the meantime, these results have been confirmed by 5 other independent working groups with excellent expertise in this field. This brings me to my point 6, psychosis prevention in early at-risk states. As you can see here, the distinction often early and in late aspects of psychosis state led to the recommendation of different phase-specific intervention strategies. In the late state, the focus was on pharmacological interventions, as the low dose application of atypical neuroleptics was regarded as reasonably and justified. Yet in the early state, lacking psychotic like or psychotic symptoms and having more time to intervene at hand, we refrained from employing neuroleptics and instead developed a special multimodal cognitive behavioral intervention. Here you can see the title and the names of the authors or validation study of this intervention. The treatment manual and the training material were published in book form and are in the process of being translated from German into several other languages. The cognitive behavioral therapeutic program, which has applied weekly over 1 year, covers 30 sessions of individual therapy with emphasis on different topics, including psychoeducation, 15 optional sessions of group therapy, 12 sessions of cognitive remediations, 3 sessions of counseling of the relatives. This multimodal program was compared with the control condition. And here you can see the primary outcome criteria. Altogether, 1,597 help-seeking persons needed screening with the checklist within the 2 years of recruitment. Finally, 128 agreed to participate in the study and were randomized to the CBT and control condition. And here you can see the survival analysis of 24 months transition rates. They show the illness indeed progressed much in the control group here, as you can see, with 20%, when in the treatment group were only 3 patients transited to 6.3%. Thus, the psychotherapeutic program had indeed been successful and had led to significantly lowered transition rates in the following first psychotic episodes. This brings me to my next point, the point 7 here, psychosis prevention in late at-risk states. Our own group carried out a randomized controlled parallel study comparing low-dose treatment with atypical neuroleptic amisulpride in combination with a needs-focused intervention to needs-focused intervention alone. As half a year, an already significantly lower rate of transitions, and in this study, in transition means the onset of frank psychosis had occurred, as you can see here, in the treatment group, only 5% compared to 21% in the control group. As yet only preliminary data have been published on that amisulpride trial, therefore the study had not been accounted for this meta-analysis here of randomized controlled treatment trials in high-risk individuals so far. As you can see here, the groups from Pat McGorry, Thomas McLeshen, also from Cologne, from Canada, had already tested low doses of risperidone, of olanzapine, and together with 3 psychotherapeutics trials and the trial with 3 omega fatty acids, the Amigas trial here. This meta-analysis confirmed a significant effect of the prevention trials included with a risk ratio of 0.34 from 23% to 7%, and the number needed to treat of 6 in the focus treatment versus the controls group at 1 year. This brings me to the last point here, the current issues in and the ethical and legal frameworks of indicated prevention strategies. Also, simple nutritional supplements without of risk of side effects or other disadvantages as the administration of uroprotective fish oil seem to be effective. In this trial, published by Paul Amminger in the archives in 2010, the transition rate in the experimental group was 4.8% versus 27.5% in the control group after 1 year. This result is of special interest as the uroprotective approach agrees very well with our current understanding of the etiopathogenesis of schizophrenia shown at the beginning of my presentation. However, Amminger's results have yet to be replicated. This is momentarily happening in the large transitional prodrome study, as you can see here under the acronym NeuraPro, carried out by several centers in North America, Europe, and Australia. A particularly promising candidate for pharmacological prevention in at risk of psychosis states also seems to be the atypical antipsychotic aripiprazole, because of the favorable profile of this substance, which stimulated us to carry out a large second generation intervention trial, as you can see here, in subjects at risk of first episode psychosis, evaluating cognitive behavioral therapy, aripiprazole and placebo. And as you can see here you can see many different centers in Germany and Austria. And this is an important question. CBT non-inferior to antipsychotics in ultra-high risk samples. Many of the previous noting findings have informed the ongoing debate about the inclusion of the psychosis high risk state in the next DSM edition, DSM-5. Defining such stage as a new diagnostic category may make clinicians more likely to identify and treat these individuals. The commission responsible for the DSM revision has in fact decided to include the attenuated psychotic syndromes, but for the time being only in the section of research criteria, and I think this is a good decision. So, this is my conclusion with some reflections on the ethics of prevention and prediction and prevention, but the time of my talk is dramatically over the rhyme. Therefore, I come to my I have reached the end of my presentation, and I hope very much that I was able to give you some informative insights in the current state and future directions of this fascinating field of research. Grazie per la vostra attenzione.